Well, as a manufacturer, saddle maker, we have one big problem is that over the time, we have a lot of issue with joints because you're pulling leather over a tree. So making a saddle, it's really hard on the hands. So as a manufacturer, we want to make it as easy as possible for our employees as well. If the treeless saddle would work, many, many, many companies would do it because A, you save a lot of labor and a lot of pain to your employees. So you also will find no equine journal where veterinarians will write that treeless saddles work. Personally, the person who came up with that, I think is a super clever marketing person who said, let's take a bareback pad and change the word to treeless saddle. A saddle without a tree is like a human or a horse without a skeleton. The skeleton has a function. The saddle has a skeleton, which is the tree. So if you say, what is your opinion of a bareback pad or a treeless saddle for the health and the benefit to the rider or the horse, then I would say, I haven't studied human or medical, I haven't studied biomechanics, physiology of the human or the horse. So why don't I ask this question and ask people like Dr. James Worsen, who is a medical, why don't I turn to my top people who I trust more, because they are scientists who went for years to learn the anatomy of the horse and the rider. And then I say, how does that work, these bareback pads or the treeless saddle? Is it actually good to the horse or not? So let's look at this picture here. I'm using a lot of pictures from different veterinarians and from Saddle Fit for Life, because Saddle Fit for Life is our educational arm, and it's our, well, academy, what teaches other people. And I'm a big believer, pictures give you more than 1,000 words. So you see two people, yes, they have saddles, and no, they're not necessary treeless saddles, but I want you to look at something. I want you to see this person up here. You see the shoulders, hips, and heels way in front. We call that the classical chaise seat. And the other rider you see totally crooked. See the back here? I have, let me see where I have this. Yeah, I had a fella in England in my courses, Russell Guire, he makes these shirts, and then you can put them on and you can see when you ride how straight or crooked you sit. So I thought that's a clever idea he come up with. And so the saddle, what is the job of the saddle with the tree? To give the rider this support, because in the end of the day, what you're trying to do, you're trying to take a pelvis or a human and put it on an animal and align two spines, a human and a horse's. The horse's spine, which is horizontal, which moves walk, trot, canter, and the rider's spine has four curves. So if I'm showing you this little video here quick, I'm going to fast forward to it. You know, I'm gonna let this roll a little bit, and I want you to pay attention what this
aimed in the saddle
person is saying. And also I want you to look where he writes. I'm not going to play the whole 30 minutes, but that's for you guys who are interested in that. Saddle Fit for Life has lots of courses who explains that in great detail, but just listen a little bit briefly what he says.
The compensation for the backward and forward movements of the rider's pelvis takes place in the lower part of the lumbar spine. With a pliable seat, a perpendicular line from the head to the pelvis continues to the lower heel. The entire tilting action of the pelvis is carried out in the ischial tuberosities. These are rounded protrusions and always lie on the lowest point of the saddle.
So one of the purposes for the horse's sake is, you just heard him say, the entire pivot action is on the seat bones. So the saddle tree has to take the weight of the rider from those two seat bones and distribute it over a larger area. If you don't have a structure, a saddle without a tree, a treeless saddle or a bareback pad, all the weight is in the center. And if we listen to experts who have studied, researched, published paper, this company here, or sorry, this university in Scotland, 2014, has shown that the horse will get massive back problems if you do not distribute the weight over a larger weight-bearing surface. So if I listen to opinions rather than to science who have given this into great detail, then I say, oh, I got a new foam, and this new foam makes it nice and soft, but it still doesn't distribute the weight of the rider. See, there's the boots, there's the helmet, there's the saddle itself, the entire weight what comes down got to be distributed as a minimum of 120 square inch of the horse's back. And if you just sit localized in one area, needless to say, that's not going to happen. So to wrap this quick up, the question, I know this is a long answer, but here you see two people riding on a horse. Here on the bottom right, you see an officer, okay, shoulder, hips, and heels. And that's kind of like you saw in the video where he can pivot, okay? And here you see a female rider. I use the slides a lot of how the correct neck position and where his hind leg is, how much a horse is on the forehand, different subject. But I wanted you to see how this woman sits differently than this woman, okay? And you will sit like that in the treeless saddle if you are a woman, because a male has longer tailbones. A male has longer or a higher pubic symphysis. So if I'm looking at the picture from the side, when, well, let me see if I have one on the side. But if you look from the side here, you see the tailbone is much longer on the male than on the female. So if I'm sitting in the saddle, what is not or gender appropriate, or I sit bareback in the saddle, I will not have the perpendicular line. And all of a sudden, your weight comes twice as much into the horse's back. So ladies, if you are 125 pounds with your saddle in your boots, you're riding the equivalent of a 250-pound rider. That's a lot of weight. Many people say to me, how come a guy so heavy rides so light? Different topic about male and female saddles or male and female gender, which I was referring earlier of James Worson, who explains that wonderful here. But we do, again, a seminar on that as well. But if you want to ride correctly, what is correctly? Soft pivoting your seat bones, like I showed you in that little mini video, then you've got to understand, male or female, when you sit in the cast, female, you see here, one impact on the front, two in the back, much wider, that's a female pelvis. This guy beside him, beside her, same height, approximate the same weight, but no birth channel. Look where his impact is in the back, okay? So the female seat bones hit wider, but the first one will hit you. As a girl, your pubic symphysis will hit the withers first. Because if you look at the top line of the horse, and if you want to sit in the right area, you will hit on the highest point of the horse's spine, right there where my finger is, and that will no rider, Olympian or no Olympian, you will ride like that, okay? And that makes that extremely hard on the horse's back. The rider will deform, either go sideways or in the chair seat, and here comes the worst part. Who pays the price? The horse. You see massive atrophy and holding up. Now, this is not my opinion. As a saddle maker, I was telling you before, it is really hard to make a saddle over a tree because you're stretching and you're forming leather. It's hard and very time consuming. So if it would be the cat's meow and the answer of all the saddle fitting problems, many manufacturers would do it. But the established manufacturers, they make no treeless saddles because A, it doesn't work. You don't distribute the rider's weight. B, you don't give the rider the support. And C, no medical papers have shown that it will protect the horse or the rider from long-term damage. So my opinion, they don't work at all. Is there a place for bareback pads or treeless saddles? I don't think so.